Seven churches now take the spotlight in the book of Revelation. Easily the most accessible portion of the book are seven letters to seven churches found in Asia. I've actually had the privilege of being in two of these places. Now, as I stated earlier, this is the easy stuff. This is the stuff we can grasp onto and see what has a word for us, what God is trying to tell us in these texts. How can we apply these to our lives today? The problem is they still also need some expounding upon. First, we have a letter to the church in Ephesus. I know your works, your toil, and your patient endurance. I know that you cannot tolerate evildoers. You have tested those who claim to be apostles, but are not, and have found them to be false. Patient endurance. It's something you'll find a lot in this book. The book of Revelation contains a diagram of sorts of one simple word, endure. To understand why that's important, you have to look at the historical context of this book. And this was written when Rome was in power. And unfortunately, they dealt with persecution. I mean, real persecution. Not just nobody saying God bless you when you sneeze. I'm talking about the kind where if you worship Jesus, you're lion food. Nero especially, Emperor Nero, decided to wage a particularly horrible and nasty public relations campaign against Christianity and told all sorts of horrible lies and slanders and mistruths about them. It was fear-mongering, pure and simple. And so basically they had to deal with this reality that they lived in. That no, they don't eat babies. They don't drink blood. They don't consume flesh. They just follow Jesus. Well, the problem with that is the emperor has this ability, we'll say, to stand up and declare himself a god. After all, we all know that monarchs are chosen by God, right? And this is a tradition that's dated back thousands and thousands of years. When you look at Egypt, in ancient Egyptian culture, the pharaoh was worshipped as a god. Well, the problem with that is when the Roman emperor decides, hey, you guys should worship me and bow down before me and deify me, which is precisely what happened. And so if you're not bowing down to this god, you are then an enemy of the state. It's persecution. It's horrible, horrible persecution that churches had to endure. So Ephesus gets this letter. And a lot of the letters sort of have, you know, you've done this well, but maybe you need to work on this. Usually when we talk to people, they try to do the sandwich technique, where they give you something good that you've done, something then that you need to work on, followed up again by something good. Jesus, however, is not mincing words. He tells them flat out, you guys have been enduring things wonderfully. You don't tolerate evil, you're doing good works, and you're doing all of this stuff, church in Ephesus. But, he says, I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember from what you have fallen. I think it's something that we, in our modern context, can kind of be familiar with. I mean, I can remember times in high school dating someone. And whenever you've dated somebody in high school, you know there's that really obnoxious period where you're just like fawning all over them, where notebooks have hearts and initials all over them. And it's absolutely terrifying. And then complacency sets in. You know, when we translate that to marriages, they tend to call it the 7-year itch, when you start getting bored, when you start getting complacent. When you're like, I know this person inside and out, I can take advantage of them. I don't have to worry about, you know, being nice or kind because, you know, we're already married. Yet that first love is so vital. That spark of love, where you're trying to learn everything about them, when your whole life is consumed about them. That's what the first love is. Now imagine all of us having that first love moment. Imagine all of us remembering how it was when we first really knew that God cared about us. When we went through that phase of pure, unadulterated joy and love. Now look at us today. Are we still always excited about Jesus? Are we clamoring about all that God has done for us? Sometimes yes, sometimes no. But the thing is, it's easy to be complacent. It's easy to take something or someone for granted until you don't have it. Jesus is imploring the people, look, you guys were so on fire for Christ in the beginning. What happened? You just sort of dropped off. Where's the love? And so the message to the church in Ephesus is simply keep enduring, keep doing what you're doing, but you have got to remember the excitement and the passion you felt for God in the beginning. Bring that spark back. And everything will be so good in your life. Moving right along, we have the church in Smyrna. And I have to pause here for a minute because Smyrna, to me, was such a fascinating place when I was in Turkey. We went to both Ephesus, because everyone goes to Ephesus if you're in Turkey. And the second ancient site we visited, really, was Smyrna. And what's fascinating about Smyrna is there's just such a tiny section of ruin that you can go in. You see, they built another city on top of it. There's a modern city on top of Smyrna. Ephesus is there, and it's sprawled out, and it's beautiful, and it's wonderful. Smyrna is just this little place that can be done in like an hour or two because another city was literally built on top of it. I like to reflect on that, talking about this letter and talking about Smyrna, because even though it still exists, it kind of doesn't. But it endured. It has this patient endurance that you can see when you go there. The words to the church in Smyrna. I know your affliction and your poverty, even though you are rich. I know the slander and on the part of those who say they are Jews but are not. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Patient endurance. You can maybe see now why I'm a little obsessed with the notion of Smyrna enduring, even though another city is on top of it. He says, look, the bottom line is I understand that y'all aren't the richest, but you have this richness in you, this love of God that you're holding on to. He says, endure, be patient. Understand that this trial is only for a while. And we today, in 2018 America, we can understand that because we understand that the world, the church, is not operating as we would hope that it is. We see beset on all sides by all different things. How do we get people to be excited for Christ? How do we spread God's word? What can we do with a little bit of stuff? And there are ways to do that. The one word is endure. Be faithful until death, and I will give you the crown of life. The trials, the hardships that we endure, that we face, are hard. They're not as bad as they could be. Thank God for that. But the bottom line is, God wants us to endure. Our hope is built on Jesus Christ. And anything that we're going through, any problem we're having, the solution is found in Him. And we can thank God for that, that we can get through anything we're going through because of God. Now, the church in Pergamum, they kind of had a rough time with things. I know where you are living, where Satan's throne is, yet you are holding fast to my name. You are bearing witness to me. Imagine being a stranger in a strange land. Imagine being told you can't worship God because you have to worship some other god. You see, there was an emperor temple in this city. And what's the old saying? If you're not with us, you're what? You're against us. And that was true in the world. Worship the ruler, or you are an enemy. Not just an enemy of the state, but an enemy of the church as well. Imagine being in a place where you can't worship God. What would you do? How would you live your life? Well, this church decided that they were going to still do what they were supposed to do. That they were going to patiently endure and worship God, which is both the hard thing to do and the right thing to do. To trust that God is going to get you through this situation. I am so glad that we are able to live in a place where we can worship God freely. I've been in places where it's a little harder to worship God a little more freely. Not horrible persecution, but my time in Turkey was fascinating because no matter where you were, when it was time for the daily prayers, you knew it. And the reason that you knew it was because they blared it all over the loudspeaker, the call to the mosque. It was beautiful and haunting because at some point you realize you're not in a place where everyone more or less agrees with you. I've never faced persecution. In college, I was always looked at as the token Christian kid, where there was a bunch of people sort of dogging on religion and things. I had one professor in particular, though, who was absolutely wonderful and treated me like an equal. As an English major, you tend to get drawn into more liberal classes, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. But what that comes with is kind of condescending people who really think you're kind of dumb for worshiping God. And so one teacher in particular always treated me with the utmost respect and sort of said, okay, as a Christian, as a follower of Christ, Sam, you know, what's your opinion on this? How do you see this that's different than how everyone else was reading it? And we were able to have this wonderful discussion and exchange of ideas. I didn't change anyone's minds, but nobody changed my mind. But I've never had to deal with the threat of death because of who I choose to worship. They did. But there were people that were not following what God wanted them to do. False teaching. I have to say, this is one of the sorest subjects for me in the Bible, the idea of false teachers. And the reason is because we would like to think that in 2018, after thousands of years of studying the Word of God, after learning what God wants us to do, we would have that all under control. But we don't. There are people who actively seek to make a profit off of the Word of God. And I'm not just talking enough to like live your life and things like that. I'm talking about houses, mansions, cars. Did you guys see that there was a pastor saying that God wanted him to have a fourth private jet? I will never ask any of you for a jet. I promise. But he was telling his congregation, God wants me to have this so we can do stuff. I mean, if you look at the way most churches operate, if you really want to see how far a dollar gets stretched, give it to a church, give it to a missional organization, because they're able to take that and stretch it and do wonderful things with a little bit, which is what God calls us to do. Be faithful with these little things, God says, and I will give you more things. To put yourself above God is the highest degree of heresy possible. To put your brand and your name out there above the Word of God is absolutely horrifying. I've gotten into some intense debates with people over televangelists. There are times when I can keep my mouth shut, and there's times when I can't. And I will not go any further into that because I don't have a soapbox to stand on right now. But suffice it to say, we live in a world where people are trying to take and twist and deceive the Word of God and are leading people astray. God says plainly, don't do that. Follow the Word of God. Don't listen to those who are false teachers. Now, what does that mean for us today? What that means is we have to be smart, we have to be cunning, and above all, we have to be discerning. That's just the way that we have to live our lives in this world. Unfortunately, there are people that will take advantage of you, and unfortunately, even more unfortunate, is there are people that will take advantage of you in God's name, and we must not allow that to happen. Hold true to the Word of God. Test things. See if they're actually good. See if they're actually proper. See if they're actually based on what Scripture says. And run toward that. Our last letter that we're looking at today, there's seven letters, so we're doing four today. Next week we'll do the final three. Because this is a huge chunk of this book, is just letters. I don't think y'all want to be here for like 3 hours as we dig into this. But the last letter that we have for today is for the church in Thyatira. I know your works, your love, faith, servants, patient endurance. I know that your last works are greater than your first. So this is a really good start. They must get this letter, they must read this letter and be like, hey, we're doing all right. God sees that we are doing things that we're supposed to be doing. We're following God's word. We have God's love in our hearts. We're spreading this love. We're doing more things now than we were in the beginning. Absolutely wonderful. And then the shoe drops. But I have this against you. You tolerate that woman Jezebel who calls herself a prophet and is teaching and beguiling my servants to practice fornication and to eat foods sacrificed to idols. We don't know this woman's name. We know that she was given authority in a church. And we know that once again, we see the problem with false teachers. I gave her time to repent. She refuses to repent of her fornication, which is not necessarily fornication. They just use that word as like the ultimate bad thing somebody can do. It might include that. Yeah, I wasn't there. I didn't have a camera. I don't know what happened there. But I know that this woman was bad news. And one of the ways that you can tell, interestingly enough, is the nickname given to her. Jezebel. You know, we hear that word, we immediately think, oh, she's one of those people. Because Jezebel, famously in the Bible, was like the worst of the worst women ever. It was this name that became synonymous with evil and idolatry and all of the things that go along with that. And what is she doing? She's teaching people highly incorrectly. And he speaks out against this. To the rest of you who do not hold to this teaching, who have not learned what some call the deep things of Satan, I say to you, I do not lay on you any other burden. He says, there are people there who aren't following her, and that's wonderful. But you have to understand, they can't keep doing this. She can't keep getting away with it. It's wonderful when you're riding high, when you think you've got suckers duped, when you think you can just stroll over people. But eventually, I promise you this, the thing with sin is that the shoe always drops. There will come a time when these fake prophets, when these false prophets are out of a job. Lord, I pray it soon. I really do. But until then, what we need to do is hold true to the teachings of Jesus Christ. To not get suckered in, to not get snookered. To everyone who conquers and continues to do my works to the end, I will give authority over nations to rule them with an iron rod as when clay pots are shattered, even as I have also received authority from my Father. Patient endurance. It's not a necessarily great thing. When you have to tolerate something, it doesn't mean you have to be okay with it. It doesn't mean you have to like it. It means you tolerate it. I tolerate a tooth pain when I'm waiting to get a cavity filled. I tolerate a headache until the Tylenol kicks in and I can relax for 5 seconds. I tolerate a stuffy nose until I break down crying and sobbing, remembering when my nose was clear, and break out nose spray so that I can breathe again for 5 minutes. I don't like those things. But we tolerate it, we endure, because we know at some point things will get better. Part of the reason that the book of Revelation is not often talked about, not often done, is because you have to find the happiness. You have to look for the nugget of hope. We live in a world where there's just pain, there's just suffering, there's just horrible things going on. And yet we are called to endure. We are called to adopt this attitude where, no, we know things aren't the greatest. We know things aren't the best, but we are called to patiently endure with the promise, the guarantee, and the hope that things will be better. I can't possibly know what everyone is going through at every moment of the day. I know we all have personal trials, we all have personal problems, we all have personal demons that we battle with every single day. And the only thing that I can do is point to the Christ who promises that somehow, some way, everything will be better. I don't know when, I don't know how, but I know this, that we have a solid, assured promise found in Jesus Christ. Remember these lessons to the church, and above all, remember the endurance. Remember the patience we are called to have, and the promise that God will get us through all things. Thanks be to the God who does this. Amen.